Are you coming to the tree where I told you?
Hey there, I'm Nicole. Welcome back to my channel. Today we are talking about Ballad of Songbirds and Snakes. So I'm going to start this off by doing a spoiler-free review with pros and cons for you if you're still debating whether or not you want to read the book. Then I will do a big spoiler announcement, in which case those of you who haven't read it, turn it off so you don't get spoiled, and then the rest of us will have a little discussion about what worked in the book and some of the thematic things and all that jazz. So let's get right into this. I actually really enjoyed Ballad of Songbirds and Snakes more than I thought I would. It was not exactly what I thought it would be. I predicted some of the things, and I have another video where I reacted to the excerpt that they published, and the things that I said, yeah, they all came true, but they were in a more nuanced way than I was expecting. So that was awesome, honestly. Okay, so spoiler-free review. Pro number one, for Hunger Games fans, this is no doubt about it. So cool. Like, absolutely, you have to read it. You don't just learn the origin of President Snow, you learn the origin of the Hunger Games itself, how they started. You learn about the First War, the Dark Days, the Capital, Pan Am, the culture, even those, like, hybrid mutts. Tons of things from the original Hunger Games are sort of at least partially explained, and you're given more information in this book. It's a veritable, like, Hunger Games Easter egg hunt. It's so good. Then there's a con. This is not a surprise, but you should not be expecting an uplifting, cheery read. Not only because it's a Hunger Games franchise, but also because it's about President Snow. So you probably already know that, but just know that it is actually quite a bit darker and more grim and grisly and graphic than some of the original Hunger Games books. It's not really YA. I'd say it's more adult. So I really suggest just getting yourself ready for, like, a sort of intense and serious read. Trigger warning for the mention of cannibalism. Be cautious about reading while you're eating this book. Once you're in part three, you're probably, like, okay-ish. But, oof. I felt really sick to my stomach in numerous parts. It was sad. It made my brownie really not good. Okay, pro. A pro is this is an incredibly thought-provoking book. She does a lot of exploration of interesting questions. This is the kind of book that you want to read and discuss with your book club. There are incredibly interesting discussions of the nature of human beings, of freedom, order, and control. A con. There were certain relationships in this book that I did not believe. I didn't feel as strongly about certain elements as I feel like I was probably supposed to. There's certain elements that I was not emotionally invested in that I think I probably should have been. There were certain one another event as well that I was like, eh, like that I felt a little, suspension of disbelief? Yeah, I was having a little bit of a hard time suspending that disbelief. A pro though, is the characters overall were very well-rounded and engaging and unique and interesting. There wasn't, like, repetition from other characters or whatever in the books. Suzanne Collins obviously has an arsenal of lovely ideas about interesting characters because they were all great, I thought. They were creative. And going back to pro number one, you see the parents or family members of people who are mentioned in the books. And then I have a bonus pro for you, which is there are a lot of song lyrics in this book, and it's really good. So overall, I have a rating of 4 stars. I think it was an intriguing read. I think that while it was not uplifting, I would not say it was depressing. I would say that there was a good balance of viewpoints, and that it was thought-provoking, interesting, and especially all those Easter eggs just made it kind of an enjoyable read. And there were funny bits, there were cute bits, and then there were really awful bits, but it was overall, I really enjoyed reading it. I gave it a rating of 4 stars. Okay, that's it. If you are leaving now, that's the spoiler-free part. Please like, subscribe, comment, do whatever you want, and we're gonna talk about spoilers now. Ah, I'm so excited to talk about this. If you wanna do a book club, let's do that. But my main point in this is the merging of animals and people. So They have people in monkey cages. They have Dr. Gall in the lab merging people with animals, people like growing animal parts. They have a lot of comparisons, like they talk about snakes and songbirds, obviously mockingjays. They have a lot of comparisons of Lacey Gray to a lamb. Like there are so many people-animal comparisons in here that I think it's a really good thematic exploration of like how people behave. Addressing and challenging that kind of animalistic, I can't tell for sure if Snow 100% adopts it, but that people are basically, they have these animalistic tendencies. If you set them loose, if they are not controlled, they're gonna like kill each other, basically. They are rabid, like animals. Then there's the fact that they are using rat poison, and Lacey Gray uses rat poison in the arena to kill other people, which again, it's equating tributes with animals. They're in monkey cages. I mean, that part is really obvious. Snow is basically repulsed by all animals except for that one domesticated cat and the Jabberjays. He loves the things that are controlled by the capital, but anything that's actually wild, like the mockingjays, he hates. The Dr. Gall's work, he's incredibly repulsed. So am I, obviously. It's like, could you get more obviously symbolic than that, right? It's literally just that exploration. But I think that then there are challenges to that thought, to that idea of humans as like primal barbaric animals, and challenges to the idea that animals are primal and barbaric as well. See, Gray has this affinity for snakes and this ability to communicate them. She's using the animals as her weapons, but it never really comes off across as super savage. She's also using mockingjays. She loves mockingjays. She ends up using them as a weapon to help her. The culture of singing really is basically the opposite to me of barbaric behavior. So I feel like, I don't know, I don't know what the conclusion is because I just finished it this morning and everyone's going to draw their own conclusions, right? But I think it's just this really interesting play of ideas of innocence, animalistic natures, and it's incredibly thought-provoking. I mean, the person with the most humanity is the one closest to the animals, and they're, maybe we're saying that, you know, it's the humans who are screwing up the animals, the humans who are making the animals barbaric. She's compared to a lamb, and they keep saying, oh, she's not a lamb, she's, like, vile, too. But, I mean, I don't agree. I think that, yeah, to me, Lucy does seem like a lamb sent for slaughter. Which, of course, reminds you of Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God. Don't know if she was going for that. Probably. Don't know really how to interpret that, but I guess Lucy Gray's ending, where she's sort of saved by the mockingjays and then she becomes a ghost, you don't know if she's like run away or if she's dead or alive or what, is sort of the opposite of control. It's complete ambiguity. So then the next topic I want to talk about is war and cannibalism and Snow's worldview. From the first like 500 words or whatever I read, I was like, oh, he's very calculating and very ambitious. And we get a bit of a reasoning for that being ambitious. I mean, he doesn't have food, he's just trying to survive, but the truth is, he says in the very beginning, he wants to be the president of Pan Am. He feels entitled, despite the fact that he has nothing in his belly, he's eating cabbage. His cousin, Tigress, is like content to make do with what she has, whereas Snow is, he feels like he's entitled to more. Because he's a Snow, he should not have to eat this cabbage soup. Because he's a Snow, he should not have to pay taxes. Like, that sort of thing. Which is, ugh, makes him very unlikable. Although the whole starving thing, like, yeah, okay. You get a little bit of sympathy, but not that much sympathy. Okay, I think that one of the defining moments that's really brought up throughout, at least the beginning of the book, was that cannibalism moment. And I think that in the war, he sees someone, a dead body, he sees one of his classmates' fathers go up to the dead body and chop the leg off and bring it home for dinner. This is the part where I was eating my brownie. It was very distressing. And I think that that was like a key pivotal moment in his worldview and character development. He sees the Hunger Games. He actually sees these acts of humanism. But there's all these symbolic things going on, right, of religion and cultural aspects, the dropping of the breadcrumbs, and the laying of the bodies in the morgue, the covering of them, the music, all that kind of thing. And Coriolanus only sees it sort of as either a publicity stunt or just plain stupid. But I like how Suzanne Collins made it so he did end up in the end basically doing marketing for murder. He was like, okay, like all these advertisers, how do we make people more engaged in our TV show kind of thing. But I think what was interesting is that we made it clear that he did have a choice. He had a choice in whether he became the monster that he did or whether he became someone who was more human. But I like that there are many points where he actually could have gone the wrong way. He had the potential to change. He just didn't. I think that they did a really good job. Suzanne Collins did a really good job showing different perspectives and opinions from Grandmam, I think that's how you say it, to Sejanus, to Snow, to Dr. Highbottom, to Dr. Gall. Things that I thought didn't work. I really did not believe that Snow loved Lucy Gray. He said he did, and him going to District 12 kind of demonstrates that he did, but that whole romance just confused me, and honestly, maybe it was supposed to, because it was like, does he really have affection for her? Is he just doing it for a publicity stunt? If he was, why would he go to District 12? And like, I wasn't rooting for them. Maybe that was the point, but I just didn't see attraction or passion or anything there. Anytime they said, I love you or I trust you, it just felt really hollow to me. Like when Lucy Gray sang that song, she was like, la la la, I trust you. I mean, he just killed someone in cold blood. I feel like that should have been a sort of a signal to her, you know, like a, I don't think that that should have been her point of, I love you so much. But that's just me. Okay, the other thing that I didn't quite like was Sejanus' decision to join the escape. It felt very abrupt to me. Like, how on earth did he find out about it? It would have been nice to actually get more on those rebels. Like, Lil sounded really cool. And what was the dude's name? Sage or something? And Blue something? Anyways, like, we see him with rebels maybe twice, and he's with Coriolanus the whole time. I'm like, how? You've been here for 2 weeks. You've left the compound twice. How did he suddenly get implicated in a rebel plot? Right? Like, what? Then there's the hanging tree in the song that I already said in the non-spoiler portion that I loved the songs in this book. I especially loved that Lucy Gray ended up writing The Hanging Tree and that it is about rebellion. I love how we heard how that song originated, because the music in The Hunger Games originally always intrigued me, and I like how she really expanded upon how there's sort of remnants and slightly different versions, I suppose, or even same versions of songs that we know now, as well as new ones. The whole Covey idea of having the crew of traveling musicians who can't travel anymore was very intriguing. The whole idea of people being up north I also thought was very intriguing. Okay, I think that pretty much covers everything I wanted to talk about, except for the thing that I thought was most brilliant about the book. And that is that Dr. Highbottom was the architect of the Hunger Games, but it was a mistake. It was a school assignment. It was never supposed to come to life. Snow's father and Dr. Gall, who kind of tag-teamed and stole Dr. Highbottom's thoughts to create the Hunger Games and to make them manifest, and how no one thought that they would happen. I think that that aspect of it, that by all accounts, the Hunger Games actually came about as a mistake. They were dreamt up in a drunken stupor by someone who was like spitballing theoretically, and then after the war they actually came into being. He feels such immense guilt about this, that he's drugged up for the rest of his life, and it was a mistake. This terrible violence, it wasn't even designed on purpose. I'm gonna leave it there, because that's where I left it, and it blew my mind. I would love, 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 if you're watching this, to hear your thoughts. I really want to hear what other people thought about this book, so please leave comments, leave your thoughts, leave your opinions. Maybe put spoiler before you start typing thoughts, but please, please, please comment. I can't wait to hear what you think. Thanks so much for watching. Remember to like, subscribe, all that stuff, and talk to you next time. What would it be if we met at midnight in the hanging tree? Are you
Coming to the tree where I told you to run, so we'd both be free. Strange things did happen here, no stranger would it be if we met at midnight in the hanging tree. Are you coming to the tree where a necklace of hope, side by side with me? Strange things did happen here, no stranger would it be if we met at midnight by the hanging tree. Are you coming to the tree where I told you to run, so we'd both be free? Strange things did happen here, no stranger would it be where we met at midnight in the hanging tree.